ओम शुक्लं वरदरं विष्णुं शशिवर्णं चतुर्भुजं प्रसन्नवदनं ध्यायेत् सर्वविघ्नोपशान्तये योगेन चित्तस्य पदेन वाचां मलं शरीरस्य च वैद्यकेन योपाकरोत्तं प्रवरं मुनीनां पतञ्जलिं प्राञ्जलिरानतोऽस्मि ओम डियर फ्रेंड्स वेलकम टू द स्टडी ऑफ द योग सूत्रस We were seeing the 50th sutra, sutra number 550 of the Sadhanapada. That is, Bahyabhyantara Stambhavruttihi Desha Kala Sankhyabhihi Paridrushtaha Dirgha Sukshmaha. So this sutra we were seeing, and we have almost completed the last couple of lines we had to read. I will just share the text now. Yeah, this was the sutra. Bahya Abhyantara Stambha Vrutti. There is what is called a Bahya Vrutti, that is external movement. Abhyantara, that is inner movement. And Stambha, where it is just stabilized. Stambha means just, Stambha, you know what is a pillar here. So that is that which is stabilized, stable. Vrutti, that is mode or manner. Paridrushtaha, Paridrushtaha, I have changed the word. Yesterday, in fact, in the last class, I had used a different word. But perfected, I changed it to perfected. Perfected in terms of, I think it, I had written examined. Paridushtaha is examined. Like pariprashnaya sevaya, pariprashna, paripashyanti. That is seeing it again and again and perfecting it. So perfected in terms of desha, kala, sankhyavihi, in terms of place, time and number is dirgha sukshmaha. There is long and imperceptible. Long means for a long time and imperceptible. So this is what we were seeing, Bahya Vritti, Abhyantara Vritti and the Stambha Vritti. These are the only three Vrittis for prana, for the breath. Then stoppage of, that is what is called Bahya Vritti, Abhyantara Vritti, we saw their explanations. And the exhaling mode is Rechaka and the filling mode is known as Puraka. We all know these terms. And the third one, that also we know because we have got some basic idea of yoga. Puraka, Kumbhaka, Rechaka. Puraka, Kumbhaka, Rechaka, yeah. That is Kumbhaka. Kumbhaka is like putting, stuffing it in a pot. You are stuffing it in a pot and then you are keeping it like that. So Stambha Vritti, Ubhaya Bhavaha, where when it is stuffed in that in the lungs, then there is no Puraka, there is no Kumbhaka. Rechaka. So these two Vritti, Abhava. Abhava means absence of those two Vrittis. Then this is what will be explained in the next sutra also. So here what is he saying? Trayopyate deshena paridrushtaha iyanasya vishayaha deshaha iti. These are all determined in terms of time, space they occupy. For example, I am breathing out. To what extent, to what distance my breath is going and affecting things. Suppose I keep some paper or some foil or some blade of grass, some about 10-12 inches somewhere below my nostril. Then that blade of grass should move. So that is the space which I am able to occupy. So nowadays, even for the COVID test, they are giving some sort of breathing equipment. They are asked to blow air into that. So like that, trayopyate deshena paridushtaha, iyanasya vishaya, kalyana paridushtaha, kshanam iyatta. So many khana. Khana is just a fraction of time which is taken to close the eye. That is what is kshana. So kshanana yatta avadharaniyana avachanna. So it is perfected like that. They are all counted like that. They are all avachanna. They are all distinguished like that. Then sankhya bhi paridrushta. Sankhya. So many shvasas and so many prashvasas. So many inhalations and so many exhalations. And tadvat nigruhitasya yetavadbhi. Likewise. Nigruhitasya yetavadbhihi dvitiya udghataha evam trutiyaha. After perfecting it for some time, this is the second udghata, this is the third udghata. There is a strange word. I was reading the explanation also. Udghata is, that is the air coming out of the, from the, what we say, the pit of the stomach, as we say, from the nabi, it comes and then it touches, it as though hits the head. So that is the reason why I have also used the word hitting. So Udghata is the hit of exhalation and inhalation is after so many seconds. The second hit is after so many seconds, etc. Similarly, they are counted in terms of being माइल्ड मृदु एवं मृदु हु एवं मध्य एवं तीव्र इति संख्या परिदृष्ट मृदु मृदु मीन्स आई एम एबल टू ब्रीद इन ओनली फॉर अबाउट 12 सेकंड्स माय पूरक रेचक इज ओनली फॉर 12 सेकंड्स नॉट मोर देन दैट मात्र मात्र इज ऑलमोस्ट लाइक अ सेकंड बिकॉज इफ यू सी द अर्थ मात्र मात्र इज गुरु लघु वी यूज दोस वर्ड्स इन इवन साहित्य guru lagu lagu is if I say ka it is lagu ka is something which is guru ku is artha matra bishak manik something like that so matra is a measure actually the literally the word matra is measure the english meter matra they are all cognate words so matra and 12 matras is one medium and 36 matras is something which is good dirgha I did not use intense tivra yeah he is used the word tivra tivra is yeah very very tivra is okay intense how we can use the word because if we tell the entire gayatri mantra along with vyahurti savyahurtim sapranavam what is that shiro along with the shiro mantra savyah along with the vyahurti sapta vyahurti sombhu bhumbhu etc And again, Sapranava along with Omkara and also Shiro Mantra. Shiro Mantra is Om Apo Jyoti Rasom Rutam Brahma, etc. So with all those things, it takes about 36 seconds. So that is a perfect, in fact, it is actually a COVID test also. In fact, sometime the way I've got, you must have seen some WhatsApp messages where if you are able to breathe in for 36 matras and retain for 36 matras, and again breathe out for 36 matras that is the perfect your lungs are perfect no need for that is the perfect check for COVID then again we saw udghata explained the udghata is explained in the yoga text as the process in which the air starting from the navel covers the entire body frame and hits the head so the recitation of gayatri mantra in full would take about 24 seconds of course not 24 it takes 36 seconds which is the medium level told above. We can also feel and check up. It depends on how we recite the Gayatri Mantra. Then, sakalu sakal vayam evam abhyastaha dirgha sukshmaha. Sakalu ayam evam abhyastaha. Evam abhyastaha. In this manner when it is practiced. So, we were actually, we'll see somewhere here. We were about to read this line. Evam mruduhu, evam madhya, evam tivra iti sankhya paridushtaha. In fact, we stopped here. Mrudu. Mrudu means, yeah, I just now told you, measured by the so many matras. So the number of matras increasing. And it need not be abnormal also. It need not be abnormal, except in the case of great yogis who will stay there in that kumbhaka for a long time. That which we are going to see in the next sutra. Then, sakalvayam evam abhyastaha dirgha sukshmaha. So even that, when it is practiced, it is sustained for long periods. And in an imperceptible or effortless way. Then, next sutra is Bahyabhyantara Vishaya Kshepi Chaturthaha. There is a fourth level also which he is saying. This fourth level also is Kumbhaka. There is, in fact, apart from Puraka, Kumbhaka, Rechaka, there is nothing else. Only in this Puraka you may show some permutations, combinations. In Rechaka you can show some combinations, permutations. Similarly, in Kumbhaka also you can show some varieties. So similarly, here it is Kumbhaka, a variety that is the higher variety, higher level of Kumbhaka. Bahya Abhyantara Vishaya Akshepi. Akshepanam means just finding fault and rejecting. That is a normal in Telugu meaning also. Akshepa. Somebody is doing array. Akshepana, we say. Akshepanam is something you are just butting in and then you are pushing out somebody. So that is Akshepana. Bahya Abhyantara Vishaya Akshepi. That is, it is throwing out or rather dismissing or disregarding. The both external, that is the Rechaka, and also internal, that is the Puraka, and Vishaya, that sphere or range, Akshepi, which is of the nature of surpassing Akshepi, that, because of that E. Chaturthaha, Chaturthaha means that fourth one. So that is, what is this fourth one? Chaturtha Pranayamaha, that is the meaning. Chaturtha Pranayamaha we have to take. So the fourth level of Pranayama is of the nature of surpassing. Surpassing, it is going, it goes beyond the Puraka and Rechaka. How? That is over a period of time, because in this norma, what he is going to tell in this sutra is, he has to make a difference between the earlier, the Kumbhaka, which is told in the earlier sutra, and Kumbhaka, which he is saying in this present sutra. The Kumbhaka, which was told in the earlier sutra, was brought about consciously with some deliberate effort. Okay, you are breathing in, then again conscious of that breathing, and then again conscious of retaining, and again conscious of rechaka. All those things that is abhyasta. Then after a long practice of that, then slowly and slowly this puraka and rechaka are disregarded. They're just disregarded. And only that kumbhaka remains. And then the person is stable in that kumbhaka mode. So that is the thing which he is going to describe here. So it is the nature of surpassing. So in that way, he is surpassing. In fact, you can't totally ignore puraka, because unless somewhere goes in, there cannot be kumbhaka. So that going in and taking out, it is so imperceptible. So they are almost dismissed. And the person stays in that kevala kumbhaka. There is a technical term also for this. It is called kevala kumbhaka. Kevala, only kumbhaka remains here. So we have come across people like that. For example, in Andhra Pradesh also, there used to be one gentleman till about 15-20 years ago, in East Godavari district. He's a very, very famous man, Mummadivaram Balayogi, somebody. So that gentleman, he used to be there. He used to get buried every year in one particular time. I have forgotten the time. So in a particular period, he used to get buried, and then he would stay for about 15-20 days. And again, after that 15 days period, he would be exhumed. And then he is perfectly okay. And so many devotees, some hundreds of thousands of devotees, they used to go, and then they used to take blessings. So that was his position. So in my own lifetime, I have seen such people. And of course, there used to be people who were doubting how exactly he was sealed and all that. But it was a fact that he was being buried. So this is the higher level of kumbhaka called kevala kumbhaka, not associated with rechaka and puraka as in the third stage. So they could be distractions for a yogi. Why is he talking about this? Because the purpose of this pranayama is not to do some feat. It's not a question of physical feat or anything. It is for fixing the mind. It is for fixing the mind and trying to deliberate on the nature of reality. So if that is so, then if I am very much conscious of rechaka, if I am very much conscious of my puraka, etc., then that is a distraction for me. So I have to get out of them. I have to go beyond those distractions. So here, the distractions have to be avoided. So I have written this year, we hear of yogis who stay for several days without breathing. Such state is told here. Desha kala sankhyabhihi bahya vishaya paridrushtaha akshiptaha. So this bahya vishaya paridrushtaha is that reshaka, bahya vishaya paridrushtaha. That again is something which is determined. Desha kala sankhyabhihi paridrushtaha. It is something which has been perfected by counting this desha, kala and sankhya. That is place, that is a range, that sphere of operation, let us say. That range and then time and then number. With all those things, it has been examined. But that is paridrushtaha akshiptaha. Akshiptaha means it has been put aside. Akshiptaha, it has been put aside. Tatha abhyantara vishaya paridrushtaha akshiptaha. Likewise, this abhyantara vishaya paridrushtaha also, that inner thing also is something which is set aside. Yeah, set aside is a better respectable word instead of ignoring or dismissing. Then ubhayatha dirgha sukshmaha. In both cases, they can be dirgha and sukshma. In both cases, they can be both passed over. Instead of passed over, I can actually say set aside. That is a better expression. They are imperceptible and for long periods. Then tat purvako bhumijayat krameena ubhayoho gatya bhavaha chaturtha pranayama. Tat purvakaha means, so what all is said above, that precedes desha kala sankhyavi paridushtaha, and then tatha abhyantara vishaya paridushtaha, then again that earlier kumbhaka, all those things they preceded by that. Tat purvakaha means that is there earlier, that is preceded by that. Tat purvakaha. Tatpurvako bhumijayat. So by conquering that stage, means by achieving mastery in that particular level, bhumijayat, krameena, gradually, उभयोः गत्यभावः, उभयोः गत्यभावः मीन्स् गति अभावः, दट इज एब्सेंस ऑफ मूवमेंट ऑफ बोथ, ऑफ बोथ व्हाट, एब्सेंस ऑफ मूवमेंट ऑफ रेचक एंड पूरक. सो दिस रेचक एंड पूरक दे जस्ट डिसअपीयर, दे डिसअपीयर एंड अ पर्सन ब्रीथ्स इन एयर एंड देन ही इज इन दैट स्टेट फॉर अ लॉन्ग लॉन्ग टाइम. सो दट इज क्रमेण उभयोः गत्यभावः चतुर्थ प्राणायामः. गत्यभावः दट इज एब्सेंस ऑफ मूवमेंट, एब्सेंस ऑफ मूवमेंट of ubhayoho, of both, both parechaka and puraka, and that is that fourth level of pranayama. Then preceded by that and surpassing it by attaining mastery in it is the fourth pranayama, in which both movements, external and internal, are absent. Then now he is trying to make, try bring about the difference. What is that difference? Trutiyastu, that trutiya level, which was told in the earlier sutra, विषय अनालोचितः गत्यभावः सकृद् आरब्ध एव देश काल संख्याभिः परिदृष्टः दीर्घ सूक्ष्म. द अर्लियर वन इज लाइक दिस, विषय अनालोचितः एंड द विषय दट रेंज वाज नॉट अर्लियर थॉट ऑफ. अनालोचितः, आलोचना मीन्स इट वाज थॉट ऑफ, समथिंग विच वी थिंक ऑफ. अनालोचित मीन्स समथिंग विच इम्प्रॉम्प्टू, डू आर डूइंग इट इम्प्रॉम्प्टू. I am just starting it now and then trying to do that. So it is not perfected over a period of time. I am just starting now and then I am trying to do that. So the trutiyastu vishaya analochitah gatyabhavah, in which that range was not earlier thought of. It is a long sentence, so let me read this also. The third one, that third one Kumbhaka, which was told in the earlier sutra, is that gatyabhavah trutiyastu, that also is gatyabhavah. What type of gatyabhavah? विषय अनालोचितः गत्यभावः, दट इज एब्सेंस ऑफ मूवमेंट, इन विच द रेंज वाज नॉट अर्लियर थॉट ऑफ बट कमेंस्ड. सकृद् आरब्ध एव, सकृद् आरब्धः, इट वाज कमेंस्ड एट सम पॉइंट ऑफ टाइम एंड व्हाट पॉइंट ऑफ टाइम वी कैनॉट से, जस्ट इम्प्रॉम्प्टू, इम्प्रॉम्प्टू आई जस्ट वांट टू डू दैट एंड देन आई वांट टू सिट फॉर योगा एंड देन डू दैट. दट इज कमेंस्ड इम्प्रॉम्प्टू बाय स्टॉपिंग द नॉर्मल कोर्स ऑफ ब्रेथ. सकृद् आरब्धः, आरब्ध एव देश काल संख्याभिः परिदृष्टः, देयर इज अ कैलकुलेशन ऑफ रेंज, कैलकुलेशन ऑफ टाइम एंड कैलकुलेशन ऑफ नंबर, विद ऑल दैट इट इज परिदृष्टः, इट इज परफेक्टेड ओवर अ पीरियड ऑफ टाइम, दैट इज दीर्घ सूक्ष्मः, दैट इज अगेन फॉर लॉन्ग पीरियड. एंड लॉन्ग पीरियड मीन्स नॉट लाइक दिस फोर्थ लेवल, वी कैन डू लॉन्ग पीरियड इज इन दैट थर्ड लेवल ओनली, इट इज स्लाइटली हायर इन दैट थर्ड लेवल ओनली ही इज ट्राइंग टू अटेन परफेक्शन. Not the fourth level. Fourth level goes on for days and days. So then this perfected in terms of range, time and number. It is for long periods and imperceptible. Paridushtaha dirgha sukshmaha. So this, the difference is not so very well explained. So that is the problem here. Trutiyastu vishaya analochitaha gatyabhavaha. The only point which he says is, it is something which is sakrud arabdha eva. We are just commencing at some point of time. And then some sort of impromptu, and then we are calculating this desha, kala, sankhya, etc. We are calculating, and there is an element of deliberate action in that. So desha, kala, sankhya, vi paridrushtaha, dirgha, sukshmaha. Then fourth one, how is it distinguished? Chaturthastu, tu, tu is on the other hand, chaturthaha, shvasa, prashvasa, yoho, vishaya, vadharanat, krameena, bhumijayat. So shvasa prashvasa yoga vishaya avadharanat. So in which the range of inhalation and exhalation, vishaya avadharana. Avadharana means not knowing, we are practicing. Avadharana here is by practicing, by shvasa prashvasa yoga vishaya avadharanat. So it is so well practiced over a period of time. Over a period of time, you are becoming a perfect, you are becoming perfect in that, and then almost disappear. They almost disappear, and then shvasa and prashvasa, we are not even conscious of it. Inhalation and exhalation are well practiced by their gradual and by their gradual mastery. Shvasa prashvasa yoga vishaya avadharanat, by practicing, by achieving mastery over that, krameena, gradually, bhumijayat means by conquering that stage, by surpassing, by mastering that stage, bhumijayat, ubhayakshepa purvakaha. Ubhaya akshepa purvaka, ubhaya ubhayoho akshepa. Ubhayoho means of both rechaka and puraka. Akshepa, they are set aside. Akshepa purvaka, गत्य भाव चतुर्थ सो आक्षेप पूर्व गत्य भाव सो दिस गत्य भाव अर्लियर गत्य भाव वाज कॉन्शियस प्रैक्टिस एंड देन यू आर आल्सो कॉन्शियस ऑफ द टाइम प्लेस एटसेट्रा एटसेट्रा बट हियर ऑल दोस टाइम प्लेस एंड रेंज एंड ऑल दोस थिंग्स दे आर नॉट वी आर नॉट इवन कॉन्शियस ऑफ इट वी हैव कम वी हैव conquered that particular stage, Bhumi Jayat, we have achieved, we have mastered that particular stage. And then we are coming to the next, this level, Uvayakshepa Purvakaha, Katya Bhavas Chaturthaha. So if you see the translation, the fourth one, which is called Kevala Kumbhaka, is that in which the range of inhalation and exhalation are well practiced. And by their gradual mastery, both are surpassed, overcome. And absence of movement, rechaka and absence of movement means rechaka and kumbhaka, absence of rechaka and kumbhaka, poraka is attained. It is thus distinguished from the normal kumbhaka. So that is the difference which he, that is how he differentiates this particular kumbhaka from the earlier kumbhaka. So this probably, we will not be able to reach this stage. Some rare person in my whole life, I have only seen one person like that. Maybe there may be some people somewhere, we do not know. But one person was there about 10-15 years ago. Then, so yeah, there is a note also. In the normal Kumbhaka, there is some deliberate effort. And the yogi is conscious of the duration of range of Rechaka and Poraka. In the higher stage, Kevala Kumbhaka, the absence of motion means this Rechaka and Poraka, the absence of motion becomes natural for the yogi. He would stay in it for long periods. Then what happens? Tatakshiyate prakashavaranam, prakashavaranam, prakasha. Prakasha, kasha means kashi, that which shines, prakasha. Kasha, the word, the root, dhatu, kasha means to shine. Probably cash comes from that, we do not know. So kasha, prakasha, prakarshena kashate, kashi also, the meaning of kashi is the same. And kashi is something which is inner, not somewhere, Benares or someplace. It is kashi is something which has to be inner. Prakasha is what, that enlightenment, prakasha, that light, enlightenment. Prakasha, avaranam, avaranam is some sort of clouding over that. Prakasha avaranam is there is some cloud, there is some veil over that. There is some veil over that prakasha. And that veil becomes weak. That weakening of that veil, which is covering or shrouding or obscuring or, what can we say, eclipsing that prakasha. So, tatah kshiyate prakasha avaranam. By that, kshiyate gets weakened, prakasha avaranam. This veil which is there on illumination, that veil which is covering the illumination. This veil is something which we, this figure of spin, that metaphor or image, we get frequently, avaranam, that image we get frequently. I was also referring to Tyagaraja's song, Terati Yagarada, Loni Terati Yagarada, Terati, that is, when you go to a temple also, that symbolically Tera, that you are putting a curtain and then you are removing that curtain. So that curtain which is inside the mind, inside us, that has to be removed. So that is the meaning. So when that fourth stage is attained, the veil on illumination is weakened. Then pranayaman abhyasyataha asya yoginaha. Pranayaman abhyasyataha asya yoginaha. Asya yoginaha, for this yogi. Pranayaman abhyasyataha, for one who is practicing. Abhyasyataha is, again, shashti ekavachanam, abhyasan. Abhyasyataha pranayaman. Pranayama, a person who is practicing these pranayamas, for him, what happens? Kshiyate, that is weakens. Viveka jnana avaraniyam karma. That what is it that is getting weakened? This karma, which is the veil, which is covering the our prakasha, realization, the spiritual path or spiritual, in that spiritual path, it's a sort of obstacle which is there in front of us, like Vrutrasura. So, Viveka Jnana Avaraniyam Karma. Vrutra, the meaning of Vrutra also is the same. Avrunoti iti Vrutra. Vrutra, the meaning of Vrutra is Avrunoti. It covers, it obscures, it darkens. So, that is what is Vrutra. So, Viveka Jnana Avaraniyam Karma. So this karma, which is the veil over, enlightenment, would weaken for the yogi who sedulously practices pranayama. This pranayama, abhyasyata, he has to very sedulously, he has to practice pranayama. Pranayama, I have to put in, okay. In italics, okay. Then this karma, what is the meaning of karma here? So the karma, which is responsible for the origin of this birth, karma, which is the causative, which is causative for this birth. That is what is called prarabdha karma, we say. Prarabdha karma is that karma which is causative, which is the cause for this present life. So present life means it has also given us some obligations, responsibilities, some dharmas. For example, I am in a particular place, I am in a particular time, I am in a particular place in society, let me say. So there are certain dharmas, there are certain obligations. And for everybody also, there are some samanya dharma. There are certain samanya dharmas and some vishesha dharmas. So this karma, by virtue of my karma, suppose by virtue of karma, King Janaka, a person like Janaka becomes a king. By virtue of karma, somebody else becomes something else. So like that, Kushma, Bhogi, Shukas, Tyagi, we say various types of people are there. And Grihastha, Grihastha are also there. Vasishtha, he is a Grihastha. So such people, all the people, they are all entitled for enlightenment. It is not as though only sannyasis are entitled for enlightenment. Everybody, every one of us is entitled for enlightenment. So this karma is the causative, is the causing factor for that birth. And when we take birth, there are certain duties, obligations, etc. So karma can mean this, or it can also mean the fruit of karma. When we say karma, it has got two meanings. Karma is action, number one, or various duties, etc. Karma phalam also. Karma phalam. Oh, this is my karma, we say, usually. Karma is karma phalam also. That is, suppose I am having some good development in life, or some sort of unwelcome development in life. So this is again part of karma. So whether it is good or bad, it is something which is karma, we say. So the fruit of karma also is included, has to be taken here. Then such as happiness, sorrow, etc., which could be distractions for the yogi. So these distractions also, they would weaken. These distractions also would weaken, means the yogi will gradually, he will rise above all these things. The person who is there practicing this pranayama, he will slowly rise above these things. Yattad achakshate, yattad achakshate. In this context, it is said, maha mohamayena indrajalena prakashashilam sattvam avrutya tadeva akariye niyumte iti maha mohamayena indrajalena. This, it is as though it is a sort of indrajala. Indrajala means some sort of magic. Indrajalena. Maha mohamayena. It is something which is so deluding in nature. Moha, moha dhatu, that is deluding. Moha is delusion. Maha mohamayena. It is something which is highly deluding in nature. Then prakasha shilam sattvam avrutya, avrutya, yep, that is having shrouded or having covered sattvam, that is antahkaranam, which is ne prakasha shilam. Otherwise, if all these distractions are not there, my mind would be very, very happy, and then my mind would be in a very, very fresh condition, or in a very receptive condition to know brahmajnana. But then with all these karma and then with all these things, my mind is not so receptive. So when I practice pranayama, then again, all those things, my karma is slowly and slowly set aside. And my mind becomes, the sattva becomes a good receptacle for brahmajnana. It becomes a very receptive. Prakasha silam sattvam avrutya tadeva akariye niyumte. Not only distracts, not only covers the mind, not only covers our sense, good sense, but also akarye niyunte, it also directs us or impels us in some other akarya, in something which should not be done. Akarya, karya, akarya. Karya is something which can be done. Akarya is something which is a prohibited action. So adharma karya. So in this mahamohamayana indrajalena, this karma, is impelling us or directing us in some wrong direction. Iti tadasya prakashavaranam karma samsara nibandhanam pranayama abhyasat durbalam bhavati pratikshanam chakshiyate tadasya prakashavaranam karma. So this karma, which is the avaranam for prakasha, prakasha means enlightenment or realization, let us say. So this karma, which is the veil for that, and also it is samsara nibandhanam, that which binds us in samsara. Samsara means that wheel of transmigration. Samsarati iti samsara. Samsaranam. Saranam. Sarati means moves. Samsaranam, that is moving in that veil of birth and death. That is samsara. Samsara, if I'm not wife, children, etc. So usually when we say samsara, oh, pedda samsaram, we say pedda samsaram is who is having a wife and then children, so many children, and then so many relatives coming and going, all those things, plus his own attachment with so many things. That is in one sense it is okay, but then samsara literally it means the transmigration, the mode of transmigration. Karma samsara nibandhanam. Then pranayama abhyasat, by practicing this pranayama, durbalam bhavati, it becomes weak, and pratikshanam chakshiyate, it declines. Shiyate means it declines. Minute by minute, pratikshanam chakshiyate. So the more you practice pranayama, the more it becomes weak. Tathacha uktam, tapona param pranayamat, tato vishuddhir malanam deeptischa jinyanasya. Whose statement is this? Tapo Vishuddhi Pranayam is not mentioned here, whose statement it is. It's not mentioned anyway. Tapo na param pranayamat. That is pranayamat na param tapaha. Anvaya you have to change. See here. Pranayamat na param tapaha. Pranayamat panchami vibhakti. Beyond pranayama. Na param tapaha. There is no greater tapas than pranayama. So there is a sentence we can put a full stop also here. Tapona param pranayamat. Pranayamat na param tapaha. Tataha, from that vishuddhihi malanam. Malanam vishuddhihi. By that malanam vishuddhi, all the dirt of the mind is cleaned away. And again, deeptischa jnanasya. Jnanasya deeptischa bhavati. That is, jnana also shines. Deepti. Deepti means prakasha. Deepti is prakasha. Jnanasya deeptihi bhavati iti. So here, of course, we have to remember that mere pranayama would weaken the veil, but it would not remove it totally. It would not remove it totally. Otherwise, people can just do pranayama and there is no need for Vedanta Shastra. So that is the reason why enlightenment is by contemplation. Enlightenment is by contemplation. Let me delete this word. Enlightenment is by contemplation. Reminds Vachaspati Mishra, that is Tattva Visharadi, in the commentary, he reminds that mere pranayama is not going to give you brahma jnana. Otherwise, pranayama parayana, as Gita says, pare niyata haraha pranam praneshu jukvati, or rather apane jukvati pranam prane apanam tatha pare. Some such sloka is there in the Gita. So like that, pranayama, mere pranayama would not give brahma jnana. Pranayama, which is associated, pranayama is a great step, there is no doubt. Pranayama, here of course, when he says, tapona param pranayama, it is a sort of arthavada. You know what is an arthavada? Arthavada means just praising something, saying that it is something which is so great. That is, arthavada is artham uddishya vadaha. That is, you are keeping a purpose in mind and then you are saying something. Then tapona param pranayama, we have to take it like that. So that is what Vachaspati Mishra reminds us. So here one or two definitions are also given by in this commentary. Pranayama to dahyet dosham. Dahyante dhyayamananam dhatunam hyathamalaha tatha indriyanam dahyante dosha pranasya nigrahat. By this pranayama, all these doshas, all the defects, all these doshas, chitta malas, because there is no time for raga, dvesha, etc. During this pranayama, you are practicing and then you are also contemplating on various kleshas, on our own kleshas. When you are contemplating on those kleshas, naturally, that enemy slowly goes away from the mind. That enemy and also this raga, dvesha, etc., they slowly disappear from the mind. So it brings about a very, very very right frame of mind for enlightenment. And some sravana combined with that, it will achieve enlightenment. Then kincha dharana sucha yogyata manasaha. So now he is coming to the point. Dharana sucha yogyata. Yeah, yogyata means eligibility. So pranayama is bringing, making you, giving us the eligibility for the next step. So what is this? Yama, niyama, asana, pranayama. Fourth limb we have seen. The fifth limb is of course pratyahara. Then again we see yama, niyama, asana, pranayama, pratyahara. Yeah, next step will be dharana. So what is that dharana? He is not explaining that dharana here. He is only saying that by pranayama, you get the eligibility to focus your mind on anything. Dharanasu yogyata manasaha. Manasaha for that mind. Dharanasu cha yogyata. Dharanasu means, that is, dharana is, it is defined as deshabandhas chittasya dharana. That is the third pada. The very first sutra is deshabandhas chittasya dharana. What is that dharana means? Dharana is contempt, that focusing the mind. And that mind can be focused on anything. It may be something which is internal. It may be something which is external. Externally, suppose I keep some small lamp. People used to do some small lamp in front of them. You keep some deity. And then to that deity, you also put some kumkum or something like that and focus on that kumkum. That is forehead of that deity. Or feet of the deity. Or bhruvor madhye chittam aveshya samyak. That is, bhruvor madhye is in between the brows. And as I was saying, we need not strain our eyes like this. And then we need not see this tip of the nose. We can internally concentrate. We can internally see this, which means that this dilation of the eyeballs will also not be there. This dilation will stop. And then at that time, you are able to see that blank, pure white frame. There is no image in that frame. That pure shine, pure whiteness is there. So in that, okay, if you are visualizing somebody, some Ganesha, somebody, you are at liberty. Even otherwise, you can concentrate on the Gayatri Mantra, concentrate on the meaning of the Gayatri, dwell on the meaning of the Gayatri Mantra. We can do like that. So dharanasu, the word is used in plural. If it were to be singular, he could have said dharanayam. That is Srilinga Shabda, dharanayam. Instead of saying that dharanasu means there can be any number of dharanas. You can concentrate on brow, you can concentrate on, Hradaya Pundarika. They say Hradaya Pundarika is what we call the heart lotus, as we say. So we can concentrate on, of course, there is no other part of the body. We can concentrate on some other external object also, as I said, some idol or something, or it may be a yantra, or it may be a mantra which is there in the mind. So dharanasu yogyata manasaha, yogyata, that eligibility, dharanasu, and also the, instead of why did I use the word ability, I should say eligibility. Eligibility for concentration, and also one attains the ability. Yogyata ability also is okay, but eligibility is a better word. Eligibility for concentration of mind. So here the word dharana is defined in the, as I was saying, it is defined in the third part of the text as fixing the mind in any place. Then pranayama abhyasa deva. Pranayama abhyasa deva. That is by very regular practice of this pranayama. And it was also told earlier, this first pada, the 34th sutra, prachardana vidharana abhyamva pranasya. We read this sutra, iti vashanat. Prachardanam is that reshaka. Prachardanam, just driving it away. Vidharanam, it is just filling it, taking it in, is puraka. Prachardana vidharana abhyamva pranasya iti vashanat. We have seen that this principle that if your breath is controlled, your mind is controlled, it's a very great discovery. I was telling you earlier also, this is one great discovery which we see in this Yoga Shastra. After all, why has yoga become very important? That is because we are able to concentrate. We are able to focus our mind on something. We are able to clean the mind. We are able to clean the mind from so many anxieties. So the earlier, in fact, I could have used that thing also here. Here when I say the karma can mean the karma, karma phalam. Karma phalam is various afflictions. Nowadays people go to all the psychiatrists. So the psychiatrists, they say the same principles. In fact, modern psychiatry, if you just honestly inquire into that, it has originated from our yoga shastra and allied shastras only. Yoga and allied shastras only. The modern psychology and also all the modern psychologists, they have drawn a lot from these yoga principles. Very honestly speaking, they may or may not agree, but it is a fact. Because otherwise, all these till 19th century, what were they doing? Till 19th century, there was no such thing. Suddenly, there is a new shastra called the psychology. Suddenly, there is a new shastra, something like linguistics, etc. So basically, when the Western society, or rather civilization, came in contact with the Indian civilization, then only so many new sciences have come. So this is, in fact, we have not properly investigated into this. So anyway, so here, the karma can also mean various afflictions of the mind, various tensions, various, the modern man is full of so much of tension. So all those afflictions of mind, they are weakened. So prachardana vidharana bhyamva pranasya iti vachanad. So when breath is controlled, the mind is controlled, it's one great discovery of our ancients. Then, kah pratyaharaha, what is that withdrawal? This is the fifth limb. Yama, niyama, asana, pranayama, pratyahara. After that comes dharana. Pratyahara. Pratyahara. That is pratyahara. There is a definite, there is some long, there is some meaning also given here. Pratyahara. Pratyahara, there is a definition here. Tatashiyate, dharana, siyagyata, manasaha. Pratyahara, indriyani vishayebhyah means from the vishayas, from the sense objects. Pratipam is viparitam, in the opposite direction. Pratipam, ahriyante iti pratyahara, ahriyante asmin iti pratyahara. Indriyani vishayebhyah, pratipam means viparitam in the opposite direction. Ahriyante asmin iti pratyahara. Usually, where are these indriyas going? Indriyas, all our sense organs, they are all outward oriented. Paranchi khani vyatronat swayam bohu. It's a very great statement in Kathopanishad. Paranchi khani vyatronat swayam bohu. Tasmat parang pashyati nantaratman. So, person sees only parak, bahu parak, only parak, we see only outside. Kashyat dhiraha, pratyagatmanam aishyat. Some rare person, dhiraha. Dhiraha means dhiyam rati. Chitta vrittim rati, grunhati iti dhira. Dhiyam rati iti dhira. Dhira is not somebody who is not like our film heroes because of our new technology. One man can hit 100 people on the screen. So not that person. Dhira is not one who is able to hit 100 people. Dhira is somebody who can control his mind. So that is what we have to see in. We see in our text. Dhira means some really competent person. Dhiyam rati grunhati iti dhiraha. So that dhira can only look inward. So here pratyahara is that. Pratyahara, pratipam in the opposite direction. Usually the indriyas are going outward. Now you are pulling the antarmukhatvam. You are making the indriyas turn inward. That is antarmukhi karanam. You are making the indriyas look inward. So now let us see what is pratyahara. Sva vishaya samprayoge chitta swarupanukara ivendriyana. I ought to have written the sutra as it is instead of breaking. Sva vishaya samprayoge chitta swarupanukara iva chitta swarupanukara ivendriyana pratyahara. Doesn't matter. Sva vishaya samprayoge. Sva vishaya means for every indriya there is a vishaya. Exclusive vishaya, because my eye can only see things, my nose can only smell things, my tongue can only taste things. So the vishaya for my tongue is different, and then vishaya for my eye is different, vishaya for my ear is something different. So swavishaya means the respective sense object. असंप्रयोगे नॉन कॉन्टैक्ट, असंप्रयोगे एब्सेंस ऑफ कॉन्टैक्ट, सो स्वविषय असंप्रयोगे चित्त स्वरूप अनुकार इव, चित्त स्वरूप अनुकार इव, दैट इज व्हेन व्हेन द माइंड इज नॉट, व्हेन माय आई इज नॉट लुकिंग एट एनी एक्सटर्नल ऑब्जेक्ट, देन व्हाट इज हैपनिंग टू दैट, आई इज जस्ट साइलेंट, आई इज जस्ट साइलेंट एंड इट इज समथिंग विच इज रिमेन्स इनडिस्टिंग्विशेबल विद द चित्तम माइंड. Where my tongue, it is again, it is not having any vishaya, so it is again, it is remaining undistinguished from my chitta. My ears, where I am not hearing anything. Suppose nothing is going into my, there may be some other noise going around, but my mind is so focused that I am not even listening to anything. So then it is chittasya anukari, it is behaving as though like mind. Mind is something which can be focused, and of course mind also can be moving around, but here the mind is not moving around, it is just trying to focus on something. And all the indriyas, they are pratyahrutaha. Pratyahrutaha means pratyahrutani indriyani, pratyahrutani, that is all those things, they are drawn inward, antarmukhi krutani, they are all made to turn inward. So that is chitta swarupa anukara, it is as though imitating the swarupa of mind. Mind is something which is the master of the senses, isn't it? Mind, senses, they may be important things indriyani paranyahu, indriyebhya paramana, indriyani parani, that is indriyas are superior to sense objects, there is no doubt about it, because a sense object is seen by my indriya, is known by my indriya. Then indriyebhya param manaha means, because unless there is mind, the indriya is of no use, so the mind only can take it and then it can process that information. So indriyebhya param manaha, manasastu para buddhi, that is the hierarchy of that mind and senses and buddhi, etc. So here the mind is the master, so the mind has controlled the indriyas, and then all those indriyas are drawn inward. When they are drawn inward, like kurmanganiva sarvashah, when kurma, that line from Gita, when that kurma, we are drawn all the indriyani inside, then only that kurma shell is seen. So something like that, yeah, that is also a good example here, only that shell is seen. So like that chitta swarupa anukara iva, so these indriyas have got withdrawn into the shell, indriyana, that state is called pratyahara. Chitta swarupa anukara indriyana pratyahara, as though imitating the form of the mind, is pratyahara. So withdrawal is that state, is the state in which the senses remain as though imitating, because chittasya chitta swarupa anukara iva, anukaranam is imitating, anukara iva indriyana. So the indriyas, they remain as though imitating or assuming the form of the mind in the absence of contact with their respective sense objects. Swavishaya. Swavishaya means their own respective sense objects. Then there is not much commentary. Yeah, there is some commentary on this. Swavishaya samprayoga bhave chitta swarupanukara iva iti. Iva. Iva is important because indriyas are different from the mind. So yeah, anukara iva. Then swavishaya samprayoga bhave, in the absence of any contact with their respective sense objects, chitta swarupa anukara iva, the senses appear as though imitating the form of the mind. Then chitta nirodhe chittavat niruddhani indriyani na itara indriya jayavat upayantaram apekshante. So in normally indriya jaya, suppose I want to conquer my tongue, let me say. So conquering the tongue is said to be the great, a very tough thing, because this tongue is something which is very active even in the old age. All other senses may become weak, but this tongue is quite strong, and then the older you grow, the more it desires. And the old people usually, they have got so many, there's so much of chapalyam, for example, for so this, that, etc., all their grand, whatever their grandparents, they prepared, grandmother prepared. So all those things we remember and we want to make them and then eat them. So that indriya jaya is something which has to be practiced over a period of time. So it is here, it is not like that. Na indriya jayavat upayantaram apekshante. So this, here chitta nirodha, we are talking about chitta nirodha where niruddhani indriyani, all these indriyani are there pulled back. When in the indriyani are pulled back, you are not, it is not like practicing any other method in order to master one particular indriya. It's not like that. So chitta nirodhe chittavat niruddhani indriyani, chittavat niruddhani, it is almost like chittam. We are all drawn inward. So that is what we see. When the mind is restrained, the senses are also restrained, like the mind. For that, they do not depend on any other practice. So if I want to get rid of any vyasanam, if I want to get rid of any bad habit, then I have to do some special practice in order to control a particular indriya. So, but here it is not like that. There is, it's not that level of vyasanam is not talked about here. So generally, I am able to control my indriyas. So that is the point. So when the mind is restrained, the senses are also restrained, like the mind. For that, they do not depend on any other practice such as achieving mastery on senses. So mind is the master of the senses. We know that indriyebhyah param manah. Indriya, yeah, this is what I told also. The senses get resolved in the mind. And when actually this, when we talk about what is called a laya, when we talk about laya, laya means what is called resolving karyam into karanam. That is what is laya. The meaning of laya is resolving karyam into karanam. In Vedanta, and also here also, what is the practice, what is the method which is adopted? That is, you are supposed to see the karanam, not the karyam. That is karana buddhi and karya buddhi. Karya buddhi we have to leave. When you are seeing the ghata, we should not see the ghata, we should not see the mrut, but we have to see the, we should not see the part, the shape of the part and the size of the part, etc. We have to see the mrut. So similarly, when you are seeing this whole universe, you have to see the karanam for that. We have to see the panchabhuta, panchabhutani. And again, panchabhutanam karanam, again the samashti, that samashti, that Ishvara, what we say. And for that also the karanam. So Ishvara is only Vayavachinam Chaitanyam Ishvara. For that again, the karanam is that supreme reality in which that that thing has manifested. So like that, we have to see the karanam. So that is what is the process told about. So in order to achieve that, the Taittiriya Upanishad, what does it say? First, you have this Annamaya Sarira, it has to be resolved into Pranamaya Sarira. So that is Panchakosha. Panchakosha Pravilapa. Yeah, I was trying to recall that word. Panchakosha Pravilapa. This Annamaya Kosha you have to resolve into the Pranamaya Kosha. That is when you are examining your body in terms of these five layers. So from one layer to another layer, from one layer to another layer, we have to go from gross to subtle, from gross to subtle, we have to go. So this gross body we see, and then we try to reject this body. Reject in the sense, oh, this is not my real self. That is what is rejection or negation. Negating is, this is not my real self. That is negation. So this negation of the body is this Annamaya Kosha laya into Pranamaya Kosha. This Pranamaya again gets resolved into Manomaya Kosha. Manomaya Kosha gets resolved into Vijnanamaya. So Vijnanamaya again gets resolved into Anandamaya. That Anandamaya again, it is disappearing into what is that Shuddha Brahma. So this is what we see here. This is meant by the expression. Yeah, Indriyebhyah Paramana. The senses. I told all this because I have used this word here. The senses get resolved in the mind at the time of laya. At the time of laya means we are not talking about prakriti laya and all that. We are talking about process of enlightenment. In the process of enlightenment, that pravilapa, in that stage of pravilapa. When the mind is silent during meditation, etc., the senses too are silent. And this is what is meant by the expression, imitating the mind. The senses also become antarmukha or inward looking. Yeah, he is also giving some small example. Yatha madhukara rajam makshikaha utpatanta manu utpatanti nivishamanaha nivishamanam anu nivishante tatha indriyani chitta nirodhe niruddhani ityeshaha pratyaharaha pratyaharaha ityeshaha. This is what is pratyahara. What is that? Yatha madhukara rajam makshikaha utpatantam anu utpatanti. Madhukara rajam utpatantam makshikaha anu utpatanti. Anvaya is that. Madhukara rajam utpatantam. The king of bees. because our people did not know that it is the queen. Our people only say Madhukara Raja. Now it is said it is the queen bee. Anyway, we need not feel insulted that our ancients did not know this. So Madhukara Rajam Utpatantam. When that queen bee rises up, all other bees also rise up. So then Madhukara Rajam Utpatantam. Utpatantam is rising up. All other makshikaha anu utpatanti, anu utpatanti, anu gachanti, like that, anu gachanti, anu utpatanti, anu dhavanti. So along with that, these also rise up. Nivishamanam, anu nivishante, when that queen bee rises, stops. I'm not very sure whether the queen bee really goes out or we do not know, but anyway, we are following the text here. When the king bee, let me say, as per the text, nivishamanam anu nivishante, when it is halting in a place, when it is stopping in that place, maybe honeycomb, they are again landing on that honeycomb. When it is rising, they are all rising from the honeycomb, like that. Nivishamanam anu nivishante, anu nivesha, anu nivishante, tatha indriyani, likewise, indriyas also, chitta nirodhe niruddhani, chitta nirodhe sati. All these indriyas also, when the mind is restrained, then naturally the indriyas are also restrained. When I am able to focus my mind on something, I am not listening anything, I am not seeing anything, I am not smelling anything. So unless something very obnoxious smell is there and it disturbs me, normally, in normal situations, all my indriyas are withdrawn and then I don't see anything. Tatha indriyani chitta nirodhe niruddhani ityeshaha pratyaharaha. This is what is called pratyaharaha. Pratipam ahkriyante asmin iti pratyaharaha. Then next sutra we'll see later. Okay, only 1 or 2 minutes. Next sutra there is some commentary also. Paramavasyata indriyanam. We'll see in the next class. If there are any questions, let us see.
Thank you, sir. Sumit is asking, sir, what is the difference between manana, dharana and dhyana?
Yeah, manana, dharana and dhyana, the difference is dharana is just focusing on something. In that there is no contemplation or anything. You are just focusing. It is just a preliminary step where I am able to focus on a thing. Just keep the mind focused on a particular thing. Then in mananam, the thoughts keep on changing. Mananam is a long process. I have read, suppose I read some bhashyam. The entire bhashyam is meant for mananam only. So that entire bhashyam, I have to see the logical developments, all the logical sequence I have to see. So that is, what is that? Dhyanam is also something not very much different from manana. That is my view. In my view, dhyana is something like mananam only. Maybe I have to just again think, but dhyana is, when we do dhyanam, dhyai chintayam, it is from that dhatu. Dhatu, what is the dhatu there? Dhyai chintayam. Chintanam means you are thinking about anything. That is mananam only. So mananam, what is that mananam? Chintanam only. Because somebody who is much bigger, much greater than us, greater in the sense, wiser than us, somebody who is wiser than us, he has given us some thought process. Okay, you think on these lines. If we are able to think on those lines and if we are able to accept, okay, we can accept. If we are not able to accept it, okay, we will have our own reservations. Naturally, we will not be there. Suppose I accept the logic which is given by Shankaracharya or Ramanuja or Samadhar Acharya, then I am contemplating on that. I am thinking on that. I am proceeding on those lines. So dhyanam and mananam, there is not much difference. Whereas dharana, there is a difference. Dharana is just focusing the mind. There is no aspect of that manana in this. And that is the reason why dharana is the preliminary stage. Then after this only comes dharana, dhyana, samadhaya. These three things, they come later. The first five are told in one level. The first five are yama, niyama, asana, pranayama, pratyahara, the first five. They are the something which is relating to the body. And the mind, dharana, dhyana, samadhi. Dharana is the very first step with that antaranga sadhana, which become the, what can we say, the part and parcel of that samadhi. Antaranga. Antaranga means which becomes a part and parcel of that samadhi, dharana, that focus is very much there. And in that focus again, The next stage is dhyana. Dhyana is you are focusing in a focused manner, you are going along with that logical sequence. So this is how we can understand.
Thank you, sir. Saiji is asking, in day-to-day life, conflicts with pratyahara, elsewhere, it is said no need to become a sannyasi. How to arrive at an equipoint?
The first line is, in day-to-day life, there are so many
conflicts with pratyahara.
Conflicts with pratyahara.
Yeah.
Since there is difficulties in attaining pratyahara. Yeah, conflicts with pratyahara means difficulty in attaining pratyahara. Okay, then?
Then, elsewhere it is said, no need to become a sannyasi.
Elsewhere it is said. No, elsewhere it is said, is it?
Yes.
Elsewhere it is said that there is no need to become a sannyasi. Yeah, that is true. There is no need to become a sannyasi in order to get enlightenment. Sannyasa is one way. Sannyasa is one way. Even a grahastha can be an enlightened man. A brahmachari can be an enlightened man. Enlightenment has nothing to do with the ashrama. Whereas sannyas ashrama may be a sort of more conducive atmosphere. It may give a conducive atmosphere. And sometimes, like Socrates says, grahastha ashrama also can be conducive for Vedanta. If we follow Socrates, grahastha ashrama also can be conducive for Vedanta. But then, in normal situation, grahastha ashrama, there can be some distractions here and there, some commitments and all that. But in spite of all that, if we can do that, that is greater. That is really great. Instead of just renouncing all these things and then going to, that is what is called a cloistered level of detachment. But here, you are in the active world. You are braving the situation. You are actively in the field, and still you are achieving something. So this is something which is not. It is a dynamic enlightenment. Let us say that is a sort of cloistered enlightenment. We should not say cloistered situation, and this is a dynamic situation. In a dynamic situation, you are coming out of all these things, and then doing a karma yoga and chitta shuddhi. And with that, if you are able to, like King Janaka, etc., if you are able to do, it is really great. So that is what is needed for the society, because if society cannot afford to have all people as sannyasis, there should be some sannyasis in order to guide us. But then all cannot be sannyasis and need not be also.
Thank you, sir. What about this day-to-day life conflicts with pratyahara?
Sorry, conflict?
Conflicts with pratyahara.
Naturally, it will be there. They have to be overcome, that's all. If there are conflicts with pratyahara, there is no solution for that. We have to slowly. The first step we have to go. If there is conflict with pratyahara, we should not start with pratyahara first. We have to start with yama, niyama, etc. We have to start with yama, niyama, asana, pranayama. Then when we gradually master, that is the reason why they are called seven steps. Though they are called eight limbs, they are not actually eight separate limbs. They are eight steps. So if you want to straight away go to pratyahara, you may have conflicts. So that is the reason why we have to practice yama, then niyama, asana, pranayama. So in that way, pratyahara becomes easy. That is a natural step. So we can't first straight away jump onto the fifth step. So that is one way.
So one more question, sir. Please explain the difference between pratyahara and indriya jaya.
Pratyahara and indriya jaya. Yeah, that is what that commentary also saying. Indriya jaya sometimes... It can be, suppose somebody is it can be for example, I have got some temptation to look at things or something like that. So I have to do Indriya Jaya practice means very consciously I have to do that. I have to very consciously practice it over a period of time. Similarly, I was telling about my tongue. So conquering the tongue is said to be a very great thing, a very tough thing. So I have to consciously practice it and then do that. So Indriya Jaya is with a particular intention of maybe avoiding some vyasana or something like that. And that, of course, that also helps this thing. But Pratyahara is something over a period of time you have already done some Indriya Jaya. For example, when you are doing Yama, Niyama, there is already some Indriya Jaya. When we are doing Yama, Yama itself is Indriya Jaya. Yama itself, there we have done some practice. Niyama, asana, pranayama. Again, in those things also, there is Indriya Jaya. Without those things, suppose I want to do some Indriya Jaya, maybe that can be taken as Indriya Jaya as a special course. But here, Indriya Jaya becomes normal thing. It's a gradual development. It is a gradual parinama, as we can say, from Yama, Niyama, Asana, Pranayama. This is a very gradual, is a sort of evolution. Whereas Indriya Jaya may not be associated with these things. It may be an exclusive thing where I want to get rid of some, it is somewhat like de-addiction. It is somewhat like de-addiction of a particular thing without reference to Yama Niyama structure.
So one more interesting question, sir. Gangadhara Murthyji is asking, how to identify soul in the human body? What are the activities of soul in the body?
Oh, this is a very totally big question, a very unrelated question. Soul, there is no question of soul or anything. In fact, the word soul is not used by our people nowadays, our teachers nowadays. Earlier, if you see the old books for Atma, some texts they have translated as soul. Earlier, long ago, maybe if you see books, say 100 years old or something like that. But nowadays, we have now become aware that the word soul can have different connotation for different religions. So different other religions, they say that soul is something which is there, which is unique for every body. And then even our own, for example, in the dualist schools say that there is something called a soul which is there in the body and then goes away, and then all that thing we see. We hear. But then, according to Advaita, if we see, soul is something, there is no question, this is something all pervading consciousness which is there in every atom. It is there in every atom, in sentient and insentient. In the insentient, what we call insentient, also there is Atma, but we don't see it, we don't feel it. Whereas sentient is something which is able to know something, which is able to know itself, and which is able to know other things. So when we say soul in the body, everywhere, all over the body, it is there. All over the body, that Atma Chaitanya is very much there. In every cell, it is there. Every cell is again is intelligent. Nowadays, science also says that every cell also is intelligent. It is not only that earlier we used to think that the intelligence is something, the mind alone is something which is reflecting consciousness and all that. Whereas every cell has its own intelligence. So which means intelligence is something which is all pervading. So there is not a single place where this soul or intelligence or Atma is not there. So the use of word soul, I think, is not proper. Nowadays, the present day teachers, they don't use.
Thank you so much, sir. That's all for today. We'll meet in the next class. Namaskar.
Thank you. Hari Om. That's all.